ओम सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां यदविद्याविलासेन भूतभौतिकसृष्टयः तन्नौमि परमात्मानं सच्चिदानंदविग्रहं. So we were looking at the four types of abhava as part of the Anupalabdhi pramana. Anupalabdhi pramana are in English non-cognition as a means of knowledge, reveals to us the non-existence of something, and this non-existence itself is categorized into four different things. Okay. What are those four things? One is called pragabhavaha. So pragabhavaha means prior non-existence. Before the creation of something, that thing is not present. So that is what we call prior non-existence or pragabhavaha. Now this is purely from a nayayika's standpoint. In fact, Nayayika even includes Pragabhava as a Sadharana Karana. So for you to create something, it should not be there before is a cause for them. It's called one of the Sadharana Karanas is Pragabhava. Okay. Then there is something called Pradhvamsa Bhava. Pradhvamsa Bhava means what? After destruction, dvamsa means you can say destruction or resolution. After that, whatever non-existence is there, that is called pradhvamsa bhavaha. Then, so post non-existence we can say, or post destruction non-existence in English. Then atyanta abhavaha is another type of non-existence, means absolute non-existence. Here the Nayayikas give a particular type of examples. Sometimes Vedantins also give some examples which are not really accepted by the Nayayika. So atyanta abhavaha means something is never there in a particular adhikarana. Okay. For example, in vayu, there is no rupa, there is no color. Wind is supposed to be colorless. So the guna color does not belong to vayu at any time. It is never there in vayu. So vayav rupaha means in vayu rupa has atyanta abhava. It is never there. It's absolutely non-existent. Sometimes people give examples like sashashringa, rabbit's horn, or vandyaputraha and all that for atyanta abhava, which is not exactly correct as per the Nayayika's terminology, because those unholy compounds are not even considered as abhava according to the Nayayika, because unless you can establish the existence of something, you cannot even talk about its non-existence according to them. Is that clear? So, and you also have to say the adhikarana, where something is not there. These two things are important. Without that, you cannot even talk about abhava. So they don't accept this Asashringa or Vandyaputra and all as even abhava. Although we even talk about it as like an atyanta asat also we say sometimes, if not abhava. That example also is given, but in this context it is not exactly correct. Okay. Then anyonya abhavaha means it is nothing but difference or bheda. So ghata is not there in pata, pata is not ghata, like that. So this is not that, that is not this. Now these four types of abhava we looked at in quite a bit of detail. Okay, in this the important thing for us is this dhvamsa or pradhvamsa abhava is nitya for the nayayika. Now for us nothing is nitya, only Brahman alone is nityam. So this pradhvamsa abhava we do not accept as it is nitya. We say that okay, you can say if the pot is destroyed, its pradhvamsa abhava is there in the mud, okay, in whichever form it is right now. Okay, so initially you break the pot, then you have pieces. You can powder the piece, then it becomes some mud powder, let us say. So the abhava from one form it goes into another, or from one adhikarana it is there in another adhikarana. Finally, if all these adhikaranas are gone in pralaya, means that pradhvamsa abhava also is gone along with that. Okay, so it all has to resolve in Brahman anyway. Brahman alone is nitya for us. Pradhvamsa abhava we cannot accept as nityam. So that is the point we were actually looking at last week. Only Brahma Chaitanyam alone is nityam, and everything, even during a destruction or pralaya, everything resolves into that. So adhishtana avasheshaha hi nashaha kalpita vastunaha, like this. The Sureshwaracharya also is quoted here, this Vartika. So whenever you have a kalpita vastu, kalpitam means it is imagined or it is just a projection, okay, or an appearance. So whenever something is only appearing, and when it disappears, when it resolves, then what is there? It resolves back into this in its own adhishtana, correct? Wherever it was appearing, there it goes into, that's all, it resolves into that. So if the snake appears on a rope, then once the rope is known, snake has resolved into the rope, that's it. The snake destruction also is not something independent of the rope. Is it clear? The destruction of snake is nothing but knowledge of rope. So it actually resolves into the rope. So it doesn't have any independent existence or anything, or independently we cannot even think of it. So this was the point we were stressing, to say that this pradhvamsa abhava is not nitya. Another important point also is, even pragabhava also we don't really accept. Understand that I was explaining to you, because Advaitins are all satkaryavadis. When you look at the karana karya prakriya, the nayayika is asatkaryavadi. Means he says there is no effect, there is only cause. Then from the cause the effect is newly born are created, and that is why he is talking about the pragabhava. So before the creation of the effect, its non-existence, prior non-existence was there. But Advaitins say all effects are there potentially already in the cause. When one effect is produced or created, it is simply covering all the other potential effects, and when one effect is destroyed, it is simply becoming unmanifest, and some other effect in fact becomes manifest. So for us the karya is also always there. In fact, we even say that even in language, to say that the effect will be there, because when you look at all the causes in action, okay, some, for example, there is mud, there is a potter, there is a wheel, and the potter is now putting the mud on the wheel, and then he is on the job, correct? The pot is about to come. So looking at that, what you say pot will be? Now, how did you say pot will be? Unless the pot is there potentially now, you cannot even think of it being in future, correct? Coming into being, you cannot think of unless it is there already potentially. This is an important point, all of you remember. So that's why we don't accept the, really speaking, Pragabhava also only from the standpoint of Vyavahara, that too, that it is not there in the same form, we also have to accept. When the mud is there as, let us say, some kind of a powder, there is no pot. Obviously, the pot is not there, but it is still there potentially. That's what we are saying. Then when the pot is created, of course, pot is there. Then you break the pot, means the pot has become unmanifest. It has gone back into some other, whatever, some the mud has now become some pieces. So now peace has come as an effect. Pot has become unmanifest. So this is what is our understanding of cause and effect. We are Sat Karyavadi. So Karya, the effect also exists always. The only thing is creation, destruction and all is only an expression in language, which really means unmanifest becoming manifest is creation, manifest becoming unmanifest is destruction. That's all for us. That doesn't mean it does not really exist. So this is an important point. This also we covered. Then we were looking at, we came to this Veda. So idam idam na iti pratiti visayaha anyonya abhava. So this anyonya abhava is nothing but Veda. This is not this, or this is not that, I have to say. So ghata is not pata, pata is not ghata, like this. The Veda, the difference, is also called as anyonya abhava. Now some people, some Nayayikas separately talk about a guna called Vibhagaha. Or sometimes they even talk about Bheda, Prithaktvam, Vibhaga, like that differently. We do not accept all these differences. In fact, difference is only difference, whether you call it as Vibhaga or Bheda or Prithak. So you call it as a division or separateness, etc. It is the same for us. So ayameva vibhagaha bhedaha pritaktvam cha iti vyavastiyate. So the same anyonya bhava, only in vyavahara it is having different names. So we do not accept that there is a separate guna called vibhaga. So bheda atirikta vibhaga do pramana abhava. Why? Because there is no pramana for that. So you cannot just your own kapola kalpitam, that is whatever you imagine from your skull, you cannot just pass it on. So there is no pramana for that. Everything is only anyonya bhava, whether you call it as bheda, vibhaga or prithaktum. So ayamcha anyonya bhavaha adhikaranasya sadhitve sadhihi yatha ghate patha bhedaha. So this anyonya bhava, again, is of two types. Now, what are these two types of anyonya bhavaha? One is sadhi. Sadhihi means with the beginning. The anyonya bhava has a beginning, means it is sadhihi, with beginning. Now, what is the example for this? Yata ghate pata bhedaha. So when the ghata is born, along with that pata bheda also is born. Okay. So it has a beginning. When the ghata is born, the pata bheda also is there automatically. And it has a beginning. Along with the ghata, Patabheda also has started. So there is a beginning. So the understanding here is what? Adhikaranasya Aditve. So if the Adhikarana has beginning, then the this Bheda also has a beginning. So in this case, Ghata is the Adhikarana, where the Patabheda is there. And whenever the Adhikarana is created, along with that, the Veda also is there. It comes into being, we have to say. So there is a beginning for this, Swadihi. Then there is another type, which is called Anadi. Adhikaranasya Anaditve, Anadihi Eva. So if the Adhikarana itself is Anadi, then the Veda also is Anadi. In fact, in Advaita, we accept different anadi padarthas. Okay. Shadasmakam anadayaha. Six things are anadi. What are those six things? You may have also studied in other texts. Okay. So first, Brahman itself is anadi. Correct? Brahman does not have any cause. It is an uncaused cause, you can say. Okay. It itself does not have a cause, and it is the cause for this entire creation, let us say. So Brahman does not have any beginning. In fact, the concept of beginning itself is there only in time, and space-time itself is created, and Brahman's existence also is beyond space-time. Such is our understanding of Brahman, that is Brahman. So Brahman is obviously anadi. Then what else? Jivaha, individual also is beginningless. Because when did the individual come into being means, this anadi kalpa pravritti is there, correct? Our karma also is anadi that way. Avidya is anadi, in fact. So if you say this individuality is avidya kalpita, avidya itself, when did it start? So let us say, I ask you, do you know Chinese? You say, I don't know, I have Chinese ignorance. Okay, fine. When did this Chinese ignorance start? There is no start, correct? It was always there. It can come to an end if you learn Chinese. But it did not start, correct? So avidya is anadi. You cannot say it started in some point in time and all that. It is always there. Till the time it is destroyed, it is there. Since avidya is anadi, jiva also is anadi, jagat also is anadi, the prapancha is again avidya kalpita, the objective world is an appearance due to ignorance. So that appearance also, when did it start, means it is always there. Of course, it can go through a cycle of srishti, sthiti, laya, but that cycle itself is anadi for us. It is not something, you can't say when was the first one and all that. In fact, that is why in the sankalpa, there is two types of sankalpa we do. Some people say, Adya Brahmanaha, Dvitiya Pararde, Shweta Varaha Kalpe, Vaivasvata Manvantre and all that. Then some people say, Adya Brahmanaha, Dvitiya Pararde, Shweta Varaha Kalpe, Vaivasvata Manvantre. So Adya Brahmanaha means first Brahma meaning. Now, how do you know it is first Brahma? Brahma, all these Brahmas are also created in every kalpa means. Brahma, also there are anadi Brahmas are there, or were there, okay, and anadi Brahmas will be there. So you can't say first Brahma and all that. Adya Brahmana means today's Brahma, in whoever is the Brahma right now. For that Brahmaji, the Dvitiya Parardha, second half of the day. Okay. So our cosmology is very, very vast. So if you look into one day of Brahma, it is a huge number. Like that Brahmaji is living for 100 years and all that, each Brahmaji lives. So that calculation you can do at your own convenience. So that number comes in billions. In fact, some people have done that calculation. Again, those who are obsessed with finding scientific validity for our traditions, they have done some calculation and say that, yes, the Brahmaji's time which is there given in our Puranas, etc., matches with the current understanding of whatever the cosmologists are saying, when did the Big Bang happen and all that. Of course, in our understanding, there is no one Big Bang or anything. Big Bang itself is a cycle. Even if we assume or accept that Big Bang is real, then there is, even our scientists say there is going to be a big crunch. So let us say Big Bang is our Srishti, Big Crunch is the Laya. Now this Big Bang, Big Crunch cycle itself is endless for us. Is it clear? So this is all pointing to only beginninglessness. Brahman, Avidya, Jiva, Jagat, all these things are beginningless for us. But avidya can come to an end. Along with that, jivatvam also will come to an end. Along with that, jagat also will come to an end, because jagat will become totally mithya, correct? It doesn't really count anymore. So like that, it's all only kalpita. But if you look at it as real, then they are all beginningless. Similarly, the Bheda, okay, why did I talk about all this anadi? The Bheda also is anadi. So here we are talking about anadi Bheda. So there is a Jiva Brahma Bheda is there. Jiva Jagat Bheda is there. All these kinds of differences are there. So this Bheda also is anadi, because the Adhikarana itself is anadi. If Jiva and Brahman both are anadi, the Veda also is anadi. Their differences are also anadi. There is no beginning for all these things. So adhikaranasya anaditve anadihi eva yata jive brahma vedaha. Okay. And brahmani jiva vedaha. So mutually they are non-existent in each other. But there is a difference. Anyonya bhavaha or Veda is there. Okay. So now we are talking about two types of Veda. Sadhi Veda or Sadhi. Sadhi Vedaha, Anadi Vedaha. But what about both these Vedas? Will they come to an end or not? Because for us, Brahman alone is Nityam. So that's what next the author is saying. Vivido api bhedaha dvamsa pratiyogi eva. So here I think there is a printing mistake. Tatiyogi it is there. It should be pratiyogi. So dvamsa pratiyogi eva. So these bhedas are all dvamsa pratiyogi, means they undergo destruction. They also come to an end. The bheda comes to an end, because the adhikarana itself is gone. So that is what is explained here. Avidya nivrittau tat paratantranam nivritti. Here also it is saying vivritti. I don't know. Two mistakes are there in one sentence. So tat paratantranam nivritti avashyam bhavat. So all these things are only avidya kalpita. So they are all dependent on avidya being there. And if the avidya is gone, avidya nivrittau, when the avidya goes away, tat paratantranam. So those things which depend on that avidya for their very existence, they are also gone. So their nivritti also happens. Nivritti avashyam bhavat. The nivritti has to happen. There is no other way. So the idea here is, they may be anadi, But santam. Santam means with an end. Ending is possible. Ending will be there. They may not have any beginning, because there is an argument that whatever is beginningless cannot end and all that. But even Nayayikas who say Pragabhava is anadi, they say it is ending. Okay, so we use that argument with them. We say that you say Pragabhava is anadi, but Pragabhava comes to an end as soon as the effect comes into the being. But it can come to an end. So avidya is beginningless, but it can come to an end. That is the important thing we have to understand here. Okay, now another thing, punarapi bhedaha dvividaha. So another type of distinction is done now. So difference itself is divided further and further. Okay, what is the distinction? Sopadikaha nirupadikascha iti. So two types now. In a different standpoint, if we look at it, Veda can be a sopadika Veda or nirupadika Veda. Okay. Sopadika means what? That which has an upadhi. Okay. Upadhi means what? So we have discussed what is upadhi before also. So something which is there near some other thing and seemingly changes that, correct? That is called an upadhi. It does not really change anything, but it seemingly changes. Like spatika is there and behind that you have a red flower, japa kusumam. So japa kusuma can become an upadhi, and somebody can mistake this patika for having some color, although it is actually transparent. So like this upadhi, we can say a conditioning factor in English, I would like to give. I think some other people are actually translating it differently. I would like to look at it as a conditioning factor. Okay. So if the Veda is due to a conditioning factor, then this Sopadikaha. Now what is the example there? Tatra Upadhi Satta Vyapya Satta Katvam Sopadikatvam. So here, okay, what it means is, if the existence of the Veda is due to the existence of an Upadhi, then it is called Sopadikatvam. It is said here. If the upadhi itself is not there, the existence of the Veda is there without any upadhi, means it is nirupadikatvam. Fine. Now what is the example for these two things? So tatra adhyaha, adhyaha here is sopadikaha. Okay. Adhyaha yata ekasya eva akashasya ghatadi upadhi bedena bhedaha. So there is only one akasha, one space, but then there are many ghatas are there, and each ghata has its own ghatakasha, correct? So that means the bheda between one ghatakasha and another ghatakasha is due to the ghata itself. Although in reality there is no difference, everything is there in space. But still in Vyavahara, we can say that one Ghatakasha is different from another Ghatakasha. There is a Veda, and this Veda is purely due to the Upadhi. If you break the both the parts, then everything becomes one Akasha only, correct? There is no Veda. So the sopadika bheda is there only till the point that upadhi is there. If the upadhi is destroyed, then the bheda also is gone. Okay. One more example also is given here. Yathacha ekasya suryasya jalabhajana bhedena bhedaha. So you have water in a vessel. So different vessels having water. Okay. You keep it outside in sun. The sun is reflected in all these water, correct? In different vessels, whatever you have kept the water, in that the sun is reflecting. So now you say there are different reflections of sun. So there is a bheda. So this is the, again, both these things are used as a prakriya in Vedanta for you to understand this nana jiva. Okay, so nana jiva, in fact, in Vedanta there is again two types of prakriya are there. One is called eka jiva vada, means there is only one jiva. The srishti itself is this jiva's projection. And once you get knowledge, everything is gone. Correct? That is called eka jiva vada. Of course, eka jiva vada, they present it as though it is some high level of teaching and all that. I don't think so. In fact, it unnecessarily complicates many things, I think. Maybe some people still think that it is maybe useful for them to understand Advaita. As long as it helps them to understand Advaita, it is okay. But eka jiva vada is not traditionally accepted. It is more like a very minor prakriya. Very few people really accept that. In fact, in the, there is a Tamil Vedanta parampara in a mutt called Kovilur Matam. Okay, this Kovilur Matam is near Karaikudi. And they have near our Dayananda ashram also, this Kovilur Mutt is there. So in our ashram, if there are no rooms, you will get room in Kovilur Mutt in Rishikesh. So they have a original Tamil parampara of teaching Vedanta, and they have some 14-15 books also. Many of our books and all the Sanskrit books, they have translated in Tamil, and they teach, or at least they were teaching. I don't know right now whether there is an active teaching tradition, but the books are there at least. So why am I talking about this? The first book in their teaching tradition is called Nana Jiva Vada Kattalai. So they first established that there are Nana Jivas. Okay. So there is a whole book for that. So there are many jivas. Now that prakriya is more palatable, I would say. Okay, more better. It is better to understand. Okay, it becomes easy to understand when we say there are many jivas. Now, how do we account for these many jivas when Brahman Atma is only one? Means we have to say upadhi bheda. Upadhi is the reason. And again, there are also two types of teaching are there. Okay, there is an avacheda vada and pratibimba vada. The avacheda vada is this ghata. Okay, so ghata avachinna akasha. Each part space is conditioned or qualified by that ghata. So there is a difference. So the difference between jivas is also like this, like the pot differentiating the space, which in reality it is not doing anything. Okay. Then another vada is there. Pratibimba vada is reflection. That is what this jala bhajana bhedena and all is given here. So different reflections are there. And if the reflecting medium is gone, the reflection resolves back into the original and all that. Like that also there is a prakriya. Now there are these, both these analogies are given in the Shastra. Okay, if you take even in Bhagavad Gita 13th chapter, I think this Pratibimba is talked about. In other places, this Avachedavada also is talked about. But we have to carefully understand these things are as teaching aids. Okay, so the problem with students is they start analyzing the analogy itself too much. So if you get into that too much, you will end up with confusion. The analogy is given to teach you something. Once you have grasped whatever is that teaching, you don't have to keep on over analyzing the analogy. Understand that. Because if you do that, you will end up in confusion, because no analogy is the same as the reality. Understand that. The reality is the one which is being taught to you. Whatever aspect of the reality is being taught to you through a particular analogy, we have to grasp that. Don't over-analyze the analogy and then end up with some confusion. Because typically with this Pratibimbavada or even with Avachedavada, the problem will be this, how did the Upadhi come, and all, you will go into that. Is the Upadhi then different from Brahman? Then how will Advaita be there? Means Upadhi also is Kalpita only. Everything is Kalpita. Okay. So that's why Avidya itself is Adhyastha, we have to say. Avidya itself is only a superimposition, and everything is Avidya Kalpita further. So there is no Advaita Hani. So even the Upadhi are all Avidya Krita only. And Jiva is also all this Upadhi Avachinna only. So that is what is talked about here. Tatacha Ekasya Brahmanaha Antakarana Bhedat Bhedaha. So there is only one Brahmatma, but each Antakarana there is one Atma, correct? Through each Antakarana we are all having an Ahankara also. Ahankaraha Aham Aham Iti. Puranam is there, correct? Yasyaivas Puranam Sadatmakam Asat Kalpartakam Bhasate. Like that. This, there is only one Brahmatma. That Brahmatma only is felt or experienced, I have to say, for lack of a proper word, as I. The I-ness which is there is nothing but only belonging to that Brahmatma. But still, each I is as though separate due to the Antakarana. The Antakarana Avachinna Chaitanyam, we say, correct, is Pramata. Even in our Pratyaksha, when we were talking about, so we are saying Antakarana Avachinna Chaitanya is Pramata, the knower. The Antakarana Vritti Avachinna Chaitanyam is Pramana. Then there is a Vishaya Avachinna Chaitanyam, we say. And when all these things are aligned and become one, then there is a Pratyaksha takes place. Like this we have defined, correct? So there is a Beda, there is a Jiva Beda, Jivatma Beda is there. Although Brahmatma is one, Jivatmas are many, and Jivatma Beda is there. And how do we account for that? We account for that with the Upadhi Beda only, correct? The Antakaranas are many. Through each Antakarana, there is a particular individuality is there. When the Atma is manifest in a particular Antakarana, a particular individual is there. So that is how the differences between different individuals are talked about. So these are all Upadhi Krita Bheda. Means the idea is what? If the Upadhi is gone, Bheda also will be gone. The Upadhis themselves are Avidya Krita. That means if the Avidya is gone, all these things are gone. Is that clear? So like that we can understand. Now there is one more type of Bheda. What is that? nirupadika bhedaha yata ghate pata bhedaha. So this ghate pata bhedaha, which is with which only we started in fact, this anyonya bhava, is nirupadikam because there is no special upadhi or anything. This is not that. For that there is no upadhi. It is there without any upadhi itself. So that is the nirupadika bheda. The other bheda which we discussed is the sopadika bheda. So nacha brahmani api prapancha bheda abhyubakame advaita virodaha. Okay, this is the very standard question anybody can have, correct? Now, if you say that Brahman and prapancha are different, prapancha means jagat, correct? This world of objectivity, or you can say this world which includes both object and subject, that is prapancha. That is different from Brahman. You have accepted yourself. Therefore, Advaita is wrong. There is no Advaita. Veda only is Satyam. That Pancha Tattva. Dvaitins say there is five types of Veda are there and all that. So Pancha Tattva they call it. So that is the reality. No. You can't say that. Because Tattvika Veda Anabhyubhagamena Veda Adivate Advaita Avyaghata. So tattvika bheda anabhyubhagamena. So in reality there is no bheda. Bheda is only kalpita. It's all only appearance. In reality, Brahman alone is. Nothing else is. So there is no, we do not accept the bheda as satyam. Bheda is mithya. You can say there are 100 rings, 100 bangles, 100 chains. I will come and say there is only one gold. That's all. That is the jnana drishti. In jnana drishti, all names and forms are out. There is no way any name and form can survive. That is why they say the Shiva's third eye is jnana drishti, correct? In movies and all, they show it as though fire comes out of that. Why? Because fire also in one way reduces all names and form into ash, correct? Into one substance. Whatever you put into fire, the name and form is gone. So fire is a jnani because it doesn't care about any name and form. It reduces everything to one substance, which is the vibhuti, in fact we say, which is the ash. Why the ash is called vibhuti in our tradition? Vibhuti means glory. Vibhuti yoga is there in Bhagavad Gita. 10th chapter is called Vibhuti Yoga, where the Lord's glory is talked about. Wherever there is glory, it is me. Like that, Bhagavan keeps on giving a huge list. Okay. So, why do we call the ash as a glory? That is because ash symbolizes Brahman. The fire is jnana. And the names and forms go into that fire, and what comes out is Brahman, which is ash, which is the glory. It's all the glory of jnana, or glory of Brahman, we have to say. So like that, nama rupa does not count for us. That is our Rishi mathematics. Pujya Swamiji used to say it is called Rishi mathematics. You can have any number of nama rupa, they are all equal to 1. That is our mathematics. Okay. All nama rupa with Brahman is still only Brahman. Purna madaha, purna midam. Correct? We say every day we say this prayer also. Purnamadah, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachyate. So the entire Jagat also is Purna. It has come from Purnam Brahma. Purnasya Purnamadaya. So from this manifest Jagat, which has come from the Purnam Brahma, you remove all these manifestations, which is also Purnam really, which is the whole actually. If you remove it, what is there is Purnam Brahma, Purnameva Avashishyate. That is our mathematics. In fact, in reality, it has happened, it seems. Pujya Swamiji used to say that one Englishman tried to translate this. So he wanted to learn Vedanta, maybe Upanishad. So if you go, the first Shanti Mantra which is chanted is this. So the Shanti Mantra meaning he wanted to learn. Then the Pandit said, yes, this is whole, that is whole. From this whole came that whole. If you remove this whole from that whole, what remains is whole. Okay. So that fellow ran away. He thought this guy is mad. He doesn't know what he is talking about. This does not seem to be intelligent. So even that can happen to some people. We don't know. Anyway, so the idea here is you can have any number of Namarupa. It doesn't really matter. Brahman alone is real. This Veda and all is only Kalpita. We don't accept this Veda as real. Veda Adivate. So like even Ved, the space. You can say there are 100 Ghatakashas. In reality, there is only one Mahakasha. Okay. Ghatakasha are all only Upadikritam. Vedaha. It's not real. So there is no Advaita Hani is not there. Advaita Avyaghata. Avyaghata. Gha. Okay. Vyaghata is not there. Vyagata means destruction or hani. Okay. Now, prapanchasi advaite brahmani kalpitatva angikarat. So, that's what. Why? Because this entire jagat itself is kalpita on Brahman. So, what about Veda then? See, Veda is one aspect of the creation. Entire jagat or creation is itself kalpita. So if we can accept the entire creation as Kalpita, what to talk about this Veda and all that? Okay, Veda is only one aspect of the creation. So there is no problem. We have accepted the entire creation itself as Kalpita. It's all only a superimposition. It's only an appearance. All these things are only names and forms without any substance. They don't have any existence of their own. Okay, the same thing is said by Sureshwaracharya in the Brihadaranyaka Vartika. Okay, Akshama Bhavatah Keyam Sadhakatva Prakalpane Kinna Pashyasi Samsaram Tatraiva Ajnana Kalpitam Iti. So, this is an interesting thing. The Brihadaranyaka 1-4-10, very, very interesting. This 1-4 Adhyaya. In Brihadaranyaka, you all should, maybe we will see sometime later. In fact, I am even thinking of having Brihadaranyaka classes later. So, it's a very interesting section. So, there it comes, Brahmava idamagra asit, tad atmanam eva aved, aham brahma asmi ti. So, aham brahma asmi, that Mahavakya comes there. And this is a Vartika in that section. So there the argument is that Brahman becomes a sadhaka. Okay. And then it recognizes itself as Aham Brahmasmi. Okay. And attains Sarvatma Bhava and all that. So that is what is talked about there. So now some Vartika, some Vrittikaras cannot accept the fact that Brahman has become a sadhaka. How can Brahman be a sadhaka? Only Jiva can be a sadhaka. Like this they argue. So there Bhashyakara also points out, see, it's all only Kalpita. So what is the big deal? If you accept the entire Srishti, everything is Advaita, Avidya Kalpita means, what is the problem in saying Brahman is the sadhaka? So that's what here Sureshwara is pointing. Bhavataha. Bhavan here is whoever is the Vrittikara. who is saying that Brahman cannot be a sadhaka, only jiva we have to take there and all that. He says akshama bhavataha keyam. So why do you have this akshama? See, kshama means able to accept or accommodate. In this case, this person is not able to accept or accommodate the fact that Brahman can be a sadhaka. Sadhaka means a seeker here, correct? A mukshu, you can say. So, what is your problem in imagining Brahman as a sadhaka? Bhavataha keyam akshama. What is your issue? Why are you not able to accept this? So further he says, kinna pashyasi samsaram tatraiva ajnana kalpitam. The entire samsara itself is ajnana kalpita. So what is your problem in accepting that Brahman itself is jiva? Okay, Brahman itself is a sadhaka. There should not be any problem in that. So similarly, here also, Veda is not a reality. It's not a real Veda or anything. There is no Advaita Hani because we are talking about Prapancha or Veda and all that. All these things are only Namarupa for us. So Atayeva Vivarane. Okay, in Vivarana also now he is giving. Okay. Atayeva Vivarane Avidya Anumane Pragabhava Vitiriktatvam Visheshanam. So Vivaranacharya also, so not only Sureshwaracharya, now the author is quoting Vivaranacharya. So in Vivarana, this Avidya Anumana, like that, there is a section which is very, very well known. So there they establish the Avidya and different Visheshanas are given for this Avidya. One of the Visheshana which is given is Pragabhava Vetiriktattvam. So Vetiriktattvam is there. Vetiriktattvam is nothing but Veda, correct? So the Pragabhava Vetiriktattvam means what? Avidya is not Abhava. It is something different from Pragabhava, in fact. Okay? Because we accept Avidya as a Bhava Rupa. Anadihi Bhava Rupaha. And jnana nivartyatvam is there, but that is how we understand avidya. So avidya, ignorance, is what? It is beginningless, but it is not non-existence. It has some bhava rupa, means some existence is there, and it can come to an end with knowledge. Jnana nivartyatvam is there. So it is pragabhava vitiriktatvam is talked about as a visheshana for avidya, in the avidya anumana. So even from this we understand that all this Veda and all we accept only as part of the Avidya Kalpita Jagat or Avidya Kalpita Prapancha, and there is no Advaita Hani or anything because of this. Even Purva Acharyas have talked about that. And also this Tattva Pradipika Yam. Tattva Pradipika is the Chitsuka Acharya's book. So it's also known as Chit Sukhi. So it's again a very, very popular text and studied even now very actively in different ashramas and all. Like if you go to Kailash Ashrama in Rishikesh, I think they still teach this text. Although our Pujya Swamiji did not teach this, but it's a very highly regarded text. And in this also, the Avidya Lakshana is given by the Chitsukacharya. And there Avidya Lakshana itself is given as Bhavatva Visheshanam is given. So Avidya is talked about as a Bhava Padartha, but it comes to an end with Vidya, with knowledge, Jnana. And it is Anadi. So Bhavatva Visheshanam cha Sangachate. So this Avidya is talked about as Bhava. So that doesn't mean there is no Avidya, there is no Advaita. So there is Brahman and there is Avidya. It's not like that. The Bhava here is, it's not the same order of reality. That's what we have to understand. So since there is a difference in the order of reality, one does not really affect the other. So the dream world does not affect your waking. Okay. So something like that. So there is a different order of reality. Brahman alone is Satyam. Everything else is Mithya. So the Satyam Mithya we have to understand very clearly. Then we will not have any confusion. So like this, the idea here is what? There is no Advaita Hani. Even though we accept Bheda, we accept Avidya has a certain Bhava Surupa. Okay. So Avidya as a Bhava Rupa we accept. In fact, there is one more contention also. Some people even nowadays talk about Avidya as a Jnana Abhava. Again, that is a very minor tradition is there. In fact, that is some people are trying to make it very big now. There is a one Swamiji was there in the last century. Okay. Swami Sachidanandendra Saraswati, like that. He actually said that everybody in the tradition is wrong. They did not understand. Avidya is really Jnana Abhava, like that. Because in the tradition normally, Avidya is considered as a Bhava Padartha. Okay. But he gave a whole Prakriya. In fact, he said only Shankara has said this correctly. Sureshwara also they accept, I think. But everybody else is wrong. Padmapadacharya actually did not understand Shankaracharya correctly and introduced this error, saying that Avidya is a Bhava, Bhava Rupa and all that. So that is their contention and they have a certain Prakriya. But even that Prakriya I think is not very easy Prakriya. It leads to some issues and all that. Okay, this the particularly the Jivan Mukti he becomes a problem in all these Prakriyas. Whether you take Eka Jiva Vada or this Prakriya where they say that Avidya is Jnana Abhava. So if Avidya is Jnana Abhava, as soon as Vidya comes, then this Avidya Kalpita Jagat has to vanish according to them. So if you are seeing the Jagat, then you are not a Jnani. It becomes all. That means you are really giving too much reality to the world, correct? Because our logic is Drishyatvat Mithya, correct? Since I am seeing something, it is Mithya. That is our logic. That is the Vedantic logic. But according to them, if you are seeing something, then you are not even a Jnani. All these problems come. So I think there is some, again, some problem in understanding these orders of realities. So it's unnecessary, I think. That's a more complicated Prakriya. Maybe for some people it is easy, I think, because we have to respect them because they are also Advaitins. They are all very committed people. In fact, they read the Bhashya very thoroughly, these people. The disciples of Sachidanandendra, he himself has written all the some independent works he has written. He has published all the Bhashyas also critically, but in some places, in fact, wherever it is not convenient to him, he has done some changes and all that, but still he has shown lot of commitment in all that. But I find that Prakriya is again having issues. Okay. It's not very convincing to me at least. So we it's better off that we go with the established traditional methodologies of learning. So even though Avidya is Bhava, it doesn't mean there is a Advaita Hani. So that is what we have to understand. So evam chaturvidanam abhavanam yogya anupalabdhya pratitihi. So all these chaturvida abhavas are known through this yogya anupalabdhi, the anupalabdhi which has its capacity to reveal these non-existences. Okay. So from this what tatra anupalabdhihi manantaram. So in these all these cases where these different abhavas are revealed, the pramana for that is anupalabdhi only. So like this anupalabdhi is established here very clearly. So with this I think we have completed anupalabdhihi. Next, we will move into another very important topic called pramanyam or svatah pramanyam. So, this our theory of knowledge and particularly the validity of knowledge. Okay. So, how do we say that this is valid knowledge or this is error? In that, we will have a lot more discussions. That is the next section. We will take it up next week.
I put up a comment, Jason Kizhi.
Yeah, so you have asked the question. Yeah, Jiva is of the same essence of Brahman, correct?
Correct,
the Jivatvam is Mithya, but Jiva is nothing but Brahman, correct? Jiva, the awareness which we have is Brahman only, it is Brahmatma only.
Yeah.
So our Rupa also is the same Rupa.
Yeah, once you accept that, then it becomes easier to accept that.
Correct, that's what.
The Brahman can be a Sadaka.
Correct. So that is what we say.
Yeah, and also in this avidya as Bhava Rupa, is because of the feeling of separation, it's a Bhava Rupa.
Correct. There is a separation.
It's a feeling, yeah. Bhavarupa means it's a feeling, right?
Not feeling here. What we are saying is, since something is appearing, it cannot appear from nothing, correct?
Oh, okay.
But that whatever it is appearing from, that thing is not really satyam, but it is mithya. That's all we have to say.
Uh-huh. Oh, okay, okay.
So, we have a karna karya prakriya where we say satkarya vada and all that, correct? So, everything is there and something can come only from some other thing which is, something cannot come from something which is not, correct?
Right.
That's an important thing. Nasato vidyate bhavaha, na bhavo vidyate sataha, like that Bhagavan also says in Bhagavad Gita, second chapter. So keeping all that in mind, in fact, this avidya anumanam later on, if possible, we'll see. They have talked in lot of detail why avidya has to be accepted as a bhava padartha. So in the tradition, that is the teaching methodology. But some advaitins, which are like newer advaitins, we can say neo advaitins, they have a different view on that. They have their own logic, I think. But at the end of the day, all this prakriya bheda, these are all only teaching aids, correct? They are teaching methodology. Whichever works for you, you have to go with that. I think it creates a lot of confusion, so I'm not very comfortable with that. That's all. Okay?
Yeah, I get confused when they use the word bhava, whether to interpret it as a feeling or as an appearance.
Okay. The bhava...
It all depends on the context, I guess.
Correct. So, bhava is used as a feeling also. So, the bhakti bhava and all we say, correct?
Yeah.
So, if you are coming from there, I understand what you are saying. Here, bhava is not that. Bhava means something which is existent, that's all. Bhavati. Bhu sankayam is the dhatu, correct? Bhu dhatu is there. From there only bhava comes. Bhava means existent, that's all. Something which is. But bhava
is it existent or is it existence? Is there a difference?
There is a difference. Existence means it will go into Brahman. It is Brahman alone is existence.
That is sat.
Yes, correct. Okay.
Yeah. And so here you are saying it is existent.
Correct. Existent. Yeah, we have to say like that.
Okay. So existent meaning an appearance. Because something has to appear to be existing.
It is appearance. That's all.
Okay.
All appearances are existent. That's why it is appearing, correct? But that doesn't mean they are real. So we are making a difference between existent and real. All that appears, in fact, is unreal. That is our logic. Any appearance is unreal because it appears, in fact. The real does not appear because it is yourself. Self cannot appear, correct?
Right.
That is our logic.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Okay.
Interesting. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. After that, we have sense of ours. done, right? They're going to be for the next class.
Yeah, I'll send you the next class, another script. Okay.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti 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 Shanti. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.